Welcome to Pinnacle Online Coaching Classes. We are solving SSC CGL Tier 1 paper. And this is paper code 615. We are going to give you a detailed explanation of all the questions and this paper that we are going to do. This is going to be according to the new pattern which has been given by the Staff Selection Commission. In this section, we will be doing question number 26 to question number 50, which is related to your general awareness. We will be doing that part of general awareness, question number 26 to question number 50. Let's begin. General awareness, we are going to do from question number 26 to question number 50. Question number 26 to question number 50 is going to be done in this part, and that is related to general awareness. Question number 26, it's here before you. Which was the second capital of Akbar? Which was the second capital of Akbar? This question is related to medieval history. I'll keep telling you that how many questions are from which part. This is related to medieval history. Now, Akbar, one of the most important kings of the Mughal period, and his capital, see, in history, in Mughal period, we hear of Lahore as a capital. Then we hear of Delhi as a capital, we hear of Agra as a capital, okay. But in the time of Akbar, he had made Fatehpur Sikri his capital. He had made Fatehpur Sikri his capital, and Fatehpur Sikri was the capital of the Mughal Empire from the year 1571 to 1585. Very, very short period it was abandoned because of shortage of water here. And the word Fateh, what does the word Fateh in Hindi mean? The word Fateh in Hindi means victory. So Fatehpur Sikri was made the capital after Akbar's military victories over Chittor and Ranthambore. When he had won over Chittor and Ranthambore, at that time Fatehpur Sikri was made as the capital. And in the honor of a Sufi saint, Salim Chishti. In order of a Sufi saint, Salim Chishti, Fatehpur Sikri was named after his name. So these are the important things about Fatehpur Sikri. Okay, he named the city Fatehbad. Originally it was named Fatehbad. Later it was made Fatehpur Sikri. So answer is C for question number 26. Question number 27. When the vice president is acting as president, he, number one, will have all powers and functions of both president and vice president, point number one. Point number two, he gets all the allowances and privileges of the president. And point number three, he should continue to work as the chairman of the Rajya Sabha. Now out of these 1, 2, 3 all are correct, okay. 1 and 2 are only correct, 1 and 3, 1 and 2, and finally we have only 2. So these are the options that are available to us in question number 27. Now B is the answer, only 2. The moment he takes over, suppose the president has vacated his post, it could be due to some reason, it is resignation, death, illness, whatever the reason, immediately the vice president will take over and he will take over all powers of functions and he will become the president, the acting president. And after that, the post of the vice president will become vacant. The moment he takes over all responsibilities, his post is going to become vacant. So, he will have all powers and functions of both? No, he will only have the powers of the president. As long as he remains the president, he will get all allowance and privileges of the president. Yes, this is right. This was incorrect. And in the third one, he will continue to work as the chairman of the Rajya Sabha. This is incorrect. The Rajya Sabha has a vice chairman also, and immediately the vice chairman will take over as the chairman of the Rajya Sabha once the vice president takes over as the president. So, what is our answer in this case? In this case, our answer is going to be, so he continues to work as chairman of the Rajya Sabha. This is incorrect. Only two. So, my answer is D. Question number 28. Which one of the following disburses long-term loans to farmers in India? That is my question, question number 28. Now, we need to understand this. What are our options? Food Corporation of India, Life Insurance Corporation of India, Primary Credit Society and Land Development Banks. These are the options that are available to us. Now, for medium and long-term loans, for medium and long-term loans, what is there? For medium and long-term loans, these are disbursed to the farmers by, they're disbursed to the farmers through Primary Land Development Bank. We have Primary Land Development Banks. These are going to disperse. Okay. Primary Land Development Banks. These are there. Okay. Now, these banks, Primary Land Development Banks, they have to depend on Central Land Development Banks. And the Central Land Development Banks, okay, these are going to depend on NABARD. N-A-B-A-R-D. You must have heard of NABARD. Okay, they have to depend on NABARD. And for short term credit, this is disbursed to the farmers through Primary Agricultural Credit Societies. So primary agricultural credit societies who draw their finances from central cooperative banks, who in turn will have to draw their finances from state cooperative banks. So in that case, land development banks is the answer. Question number 28, land development banks. Land development banks, why? Because for medium and long term loans, they are disbursed to the farmer through primary land development banks, as I just told you, who depend upon the Central Land Development Bank, and these depend on NABARD. Question number 29. Let us take a look at question number 29. Which of the following is the maximum number of electrons that can be present in M shell? This is our question. So this is a question related to physics. Okay, which of the following is the maximum number of electrons that can be present in M shell? Question number 29. Now, the maximum number of electrons that can occupy a specific energetic level, they can be found from a formula. And what is the formula? Formula for electron capacity. It's given here. Formula for electron capacity. What is the formula? The formula is going to be 2n square. 2n square is the formula. What does this variable n represent? The variable n represents principal quantum number. It represents the principal quantum number. And we have been asked M shell. M shell has how many? What is the maximum number of electrons? Now, M shell, it belongs to the third energy level. M shell belongs to the third energy level. So, this N is going to be replaced by 3. So, 2, 3 square. This is the question. Now, 2 into 3 into 3. What is the answer? The answer is 18. So, here is my answer. Answer is 18. Question 29. Answer is 18. After question number 29, let us move on to question number 30. Read the question. The question is related to biology. Lot of questions these days on biology and geography. So, make sure these sections are strong enough. Question number 30. Take a look. A cell increases in volume when it is placed in hypertonic solution, hypotonic solution, isotonic solution, and finally after that we have none of these. Now, to do this question, first let me explain to you what is a hypertonic solution, what is hypotonic, what is isotonic solution. Okay, question number 30. Okay, now what is a hypertonic, hypotonic, isotonic solution? Question number 30. Now, in this question, first and foremost, you need to know what is osmosis. Now, what is osmosis? You must have heard of this in biology. Osmosis is going to be a process. If I explain to you briefly here, then osmosis. It's a process by which a fluid is transferred through a semi-permeable membrane. A fluid is going to be transferred through a semi-permeable membrane. I'll give you a small example. Suppose there is a cell in a fluid, then there, the cell has a semi-permeable membrane. There is going to be transfer of fluid from outside to inside or from inside to outside. This transfer is known as osmosis in a layman's language. This is osmosis. Now osmosis, it can be a the cell can be placed in a hypertonic solution, a hypotonic solution or an isotonic solution. Now we need to understand what is a hypertonic solution, what is a hypotonic solution for question number 30. Isotonic solution is one where the concentration of solutes inside and outside the cell are same. So suppose this is my solution and this is the cell. The concentration of the solutes in the cell inside and outside in the solution both are same. So in that situation there is a balance in this situation. This is a isotonic solution where the solutes in the cell as well as in the solution both are same. What happens in a hypotonic solution? In a hypotonic solution, concentration of solutes is greater inside the cell. Now this is the cell, so the concentration of solutes is greater inside the cell than outside. So what is going to happen in this situation? We will talk about that also. Then we have a hypertonic solution. In a hypertonic solution, this is the cell. Okay, in this what is going to happen? Concentration of solutes inside is lesser than outside. So these are the three situations. Okay, these are the three situations. Now what is going to happen if in question number 30, the answer is going to be B, hypotonic solution. As I told you, when a cell is placed in a hypotonic solution, the water will rush into the membrane. Water rushes into the membrane, which will increase the volume of the cell. Now what was a hypotonic solution? In hypotonic solution, concentration of solutes is greater inside the cell. So to balance it, by the process of osmosis, there is an attempt to balance the solutes. So water is going to rush into the cell so that the fluid concentration is increased inside the cell. Okay, the water rushes into the membrane and it will increase the volume of the cell. When the volume of the cell is going to get increased, it will push against the cell wall. And at this point, the cell is said to be turgid. The cell will become turgid. Turgid means a strong cell. Turgidity is very important to maintain rigidness. And a healthy plant cell, it is going to be turgid. So what is my answer for question number 30? The answer is going to be hypotonic solution. Question number 31. Now it says, question number 31, it says, the process of emissions involves diffusion, capillary absorption, both A and B. Now question number 31. Now first and foremost, we need to understand what is emissions, I-M-B-I-T-I-O-N-S. What is emissions? Question number 31. Emissions is, it is the uptake or absorption of water. It is simply uptake or absorption of water. Okay. And this happens without forming a solution. No solution is going to be formed. It is the uptake or absorption of water without the forming of solution. That is known as I-M-B-I-T-I-O-N-S, emissions. Okay, that is known as emissions. The substances absorbing water, they are known as imbibitants, and these will not dissolve in water. That is most important. And this process of imbibition is very, very important, and it starts the process of germination. It starts the process of germination. So what exactly happens in imbibitions? Exactly, absorption of water happens. So what is my answer for question number 31? My answer is C, question number 31. Question number 32. This question was also related to biology. Important. A lot of questions on biology these days. Question number 32. Purity of a metal can be determined with the help of Pascal's law, Boyle's law, Archimedes principle, conservation of mass principle. The moment you open any 7th standard book of physics, you will get to know what is Archimedes principle. In a layman's language, what is Archimedes principle? Archimedes principle is related to when a body is partially or completely, it is going to be immersed in a fluid, then there's going to be an upward force which is going to act on the fluid, and the fluid displaced is going to be equivalent to the force which acted on the body. That is Archimedes' principle. Boyle's law. Boyle's law is related to heat, and Pascal's law is related to pressure. So these two get eliminated. Now, Archimedes' principle, it is used to find out the purity of a metal. How does this happen? Now, what happens in Archimedes' principle? If we will take in question number 32, Archimedes' principle is the answer. First, mark your answer, and then I will explain to you how purity of a metal is determined with the help of Archimedes' principle. Now, metals have different densities. And that is the reason they will have a different volume, and at the same time they are going to have different weights. Different metals will have different densities, and due to this they have different volumes and they are going to have different weights. So a pure metal is going to have a different density, and once there are impurities in it, the density is going to change. So what are we going to do? We are going to put the pure metal in water, and then we are going to see the amount of fluid that it has displaced, or the amount of liquid it has displaced, the volume of the liquid. And similarly, we are going to take one with impurities, and by calculating these, we will be able to judge impurities present in any metal. And this is used to check mostly gold. Because the displaced water by a metal is going to be equal to its volume. A denser metal will displace less water. And if there are more impurities, then more water is going to be displaced. So question 23, answer is Archimedes' principle. Question number 33, the concept of tissue culture was introduced by. Question number 33. So in other words, who introduced the concept of tissue culture? Question 33, my answer is going to be, for question number 33, C. Answer is going to be C. Okay, after that, let's move on to question number 34. The first shore based. Make a correction, this is a typing error. The first shore based integrated steel plant in the country is. Now for question number 34, answer is Visakhapatnam. The Visakhapatnam steel plant, it is also known as Vizag steel plant, very popularly known as Vizag steel plant. It was set up in the year 1971. Okay, so this was the first shore based steel plant. Question number 35. Two bodies kept at a certain distance feel a gravitational force F to each other. If the distance between them is made double the former distance, the force will be. We have options 2F, 1 by 2 into F, 4F, and finally we have 1 by 4 into F. Question number 35. Now, we have a formula, F is equal to G into M1 into M2, okay, divided by D square. Only this is going to be divided by D square, M1 into M2 divided by D square. And this is the formula of what here, now let us see. In this case, F is going to be your gravitational force, okay. F is the gravitational force, M1 and M2 are the masses of the objects. G is the universal gravitational force. And D is the distance between the two objects. Okay. Now, the gravitational force is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. So, if the distance between the two bodies is going to be doubled, the force of gravity is reduced to 1 by 4. If that becomes doubled, the force of gravity will be reduced to 1 by 4. And that is the reason we have 1 by 4 here. Our answer is going to be D. For question 35, answer is T. Question number 36. What is the ancient school of law? Our options are philosophical school, historical school, analytical school, sociological school. These are our options for question number 36. Now, these are the modern schools of law are law school, analytical school. Analytical school is a modern school of law, analytical school. Historical school is a modern school of law, okay. Sociological school, this is also a modern school of law. All these are modern schools of law. The principal modern schools of law, in fact, are the law school, analytical school, historical, there's another one, comparative and sociological. So, okay. So, the philosophical school, this is one of the ancient schools of law. This is one of the ancient schools of law, philosophical school. So, that is our answer, question number 36. Question number 37. This is related to economics. A philosophy that the worker should share in industrial decisions is termed as. A philosophy that workers should share in the industrial decision is termed as question number 37. For this, the answer is industrial democracy. Question number 37, answer is A. Industrial democracy. What is industrial democracy? It is an arrangement, and in this arrangement, workers making decisions, their responsibility, their authority in the workplace, all this is going to be discussed about. Okay, all this is going to be discussed about. But in participative management, their workers are listened to and they take part in decision making process. In industrial democracy, workers will not take part in decision making process. The answer is A. Question number 38. The first country which discovered sea route to India was. Question number 38, the first country which discovered sea route to India was Portugal, P-O-R-T-U-G-A-L, Portugal. Very important. You must have heard of Vasco da Gama coming to India, Vasco da Gama, he discovered the sea route to India, etc. So, here we have by sea, so Vasco da Gama is the answer. Question number 38, okay. And to be precise, he came in May 1498. This was when he came. And once he came, this was a big, big, big discovery, because after that, many foreigners came to India. Question number 38, answer is A. Question number 39. Name the condition which influences the development of plants into distinctive forms. What kind of plants are going to develop? Will they be tall trees? Will they have a dense canopy? Will they go deep down into will they be evergreen trees? Will they be tropical trees? What kind of trees are going to develop? Will they be trees which cannot stand much heat? What are the conditions which influence the development of plants into distinctive forms? Question number 39. Now, plants have the climatic conditions of a place. The climatic conditions of a place play a very, very important role to determine what kind of plants. And what do we mean by climatic conditions? By climatic conditions, we mean temperature of the place. By climatic conditions, we mean the rainfall, the kind of amount of rainfall which is there. These two are very, very important. And then this temperature and rainfall will determine the kind of soil that is going to be there. So, the most important are going to be the climatic conditions. 39A, climatic conditions. In fact, in geography, we have Copenhagen's classification. And under that Copenhagen's classification, he has said that climatic conditions greatly influence the type of plants which will grow in a place. So, 39 answer is A. Question number 40, very, very important. Fixation of nitrogen in the soil. Fixation of nitrogen in the soil. You must have heard of nitrogen fixation in the soil, okay? Is done by virus, fungi, bacteria or protozoa. These are the four options available. Now we have a nitrogen fixing bacteria. And where will we find this bacteria? This bacteria is going to be found in leguminous roots of leguminous plants. So we have a nitrogen fixation bacteria. It is going to be found in the roots of leguminous plants like soybeans, peanuts, etc. And in the roots of these plants, we will find this bacteria. And you must have heard the name of the bacteria, Rhizobia. Rhizobia is a nitrogen fixing bacteria. There are others also. This is the most important one. Question number 40, the answer is going to be C, bacteria. Question number 41. Pinna, external ear is present in. Question number 41. Pinna, the external ear is present in. Amphibians, fish, mammals or reptiles. Amphibians can live both on land and water. Okay. Fishes, they are aquatic animals. Mammals, those that feed their young ones, they give birth to young ones. And then finally we have reptiles for question number 41. What is pinna? First and foremost, pinna is the external ear. And this is found in terrestrial mammals. Terrestrial mammals means mammals found on land. Even we are terrestrial mammals. So the answer is terrestrial mammals. This is our answer C. Question number 42. Cells become turgid because of. Question number 42. I have already explained it to you in one of the previous questions. What is turgidity? Question number 42. Now let us move on to this. Now, when the plant cell is going to be placed in a hypotonic solution, it takes up water by osmosis. Hypotonic solution means water is going to move inwards. Okay. Then the cell is going to absorb water, and when it is going to absorb water, it is going to become tight. It will start swelling, and there will be pressure against the soil. There is going to be pressure against the cell wall, and this situation is known as a turgid situation when it becomes tight. Reverse is known as flaccid. Okay. The cell is going to become swollen and hard, and this will happen because of endosmosis. What happens in endosmosis? The fluid moves inwards toward the cells, and in exosmosis it is going to move outwards. So for 42, the answer is C. 43. Which measure of memory is the largest? A little bit of computers. Question number 43. Question number 43 asks us, which measure of memory is the largest? Is it megabyte? Is it gigabyte? Is it terabyte? Is it kilobyte? Don't we speak these days? What is the capacity of the pen drive? What is the capacity of the hard drive, etc.? Hard disk, then they're going to say, oh, this is the capacity. So among these, megabyte, gigabyte, terabyte, kilobyte, etc., which is the largest? Which measure of memory is the largest? Now, one megabyte, MB is megabyte. This is equal to 1024 kilobytes. So definitely megabyte is bigger than kilobyte. So kilobyte gets eliminated. Then we have TB, terabyte and gigabyte. Now 1 gigabyte, 1 GB is equivalent to 1024 KB. So this KB is already eliminated, we have seen. And 1 kilobyte is equal to then we have terabyte. Where is terabyte? Here we have terabyte. Okay. 1 terabyte is equal to 1000 gigabyte. So that means in this question number 43, you should have knowledge about digital information for such kind of questions. For question number 43, answer is C, terabyte. Question number 44. Who introduced the Indian University Act? Question number 44. This Indian Universities Act, it was introduced in the early 1900s. Okay. The Indian Universities Act, it was passed by Lord Curzon. Very, very important. This question is from modern India. And Lord Curzon is known for two things. One is partition of Bengal, and the next is the introduction of Indian Universities Act. And by passing this act, he had tried to strengthen the hold of the Britishers over the Indian universities, because the students of the universities were getting very active in the national movement. Okay. So answer, who introduced the Indian Universities Act? Answer is going to be Lord Curzon. For question 44, answer is A. Question number 45. Which of the following is the inalienable attribute of the parliamentary system of government? Question number 45, answer is B. Question number 45, fusion of executive and the legislature. Very, very important. Fusion. A parliamentary system is that in which the democratic governance of a state and the executive branch, derives its democratic legitimacy from and is held accountable to legislature. So in this case, answer is going to be B. Which Indian industry is employing large number of workers? Question number 46. Workers are in the iron and steel industry. Workers in iron and steel industry, they are there for 200 different kinds of jobs. 200 different kind of jobs are there, and about 80% of all workers are engaged in moving raw material and steel. After the products are made, the steel products are moved from place to place. They are involved in that, and there's a lot of machinery. In addition, there are other workers which are needed for clerical work and other technical, administrative and supervisory work. So the answer in question number 46 is iron and steel. Question number 47. During the Second World War, which one of the following countries was not one of the three Axis powers which fought against the Allied powers? So, Second World War, it started on 1st September 1939. This is the date, okay? Now, there were two parties between whom it was fought. One was your Axis powers and the other was Axis powers. Axis powers are Germany, Italy and Japan. Okay, and this Germany, Italy and Axis powers was the coalition by Germany, Italy and Japan. Let me just write it here. Germany, then we have Italy and finally we have Japan. Okay, now they fought against the Allied powers. Allied powers which had all the others, France, Britain, etc. Now, question number 47, answer is C, China. The answer is C, China. During the Second World War, which one of the following countries was not one of the three Axis powers which fought against Allied powers? So, answer is China. We already have Germany, Italy and Japan. I told you they were among the Axis powers. Answer is China. Question number 48. Breaking down of rock in stew is known as... Instew means breaking. There are two things. One is instew and one is extew. This is the, you must have heard of instew conservation, extew conservation. Instew means on that place itself. Extew means somewhere else. So breaking down of a rock in extew is known as, that is known as weathering. Question number 48, answer is weathering. Weathering means breaking down of the rock there itself. But when it is going to be transported from there by water or by air or by some other medium, then it will become erosion. So just mere breaking down, that is known as weathering. Question number 48. Weathering is breaking down of the rock or the soil or any other mineral as well as artificial material that come in contact with the earth's atmosphere, biota and waters. There is going to be no movement in weathering, but in erosion, there is going to be movement. Question number 49. The longest river of Europe, if I ever ask anybody which is the name of river of Europe, the first answer that they give me is D, ma'am, Volga. Yes, Volga is also the longest river of Europe. It's the longest river. Volga is the largest river in Europe, okay? In terms of length also, it is the largest. In terms of discharge of water, its watershed area, and it flows through western part of Russia. It flows through the western part of Russia. Very, very important river for Russia. Okay? And it is viewed as the national river for Russia. Answer is D. Question number 50. Sveriges Riksbank Prize 2015 was awarded to... Question number 50, the answer is A, Angus Deaton, A-N-G-U-S, Angus, D-E-A-T-O-N, Deaton, question number 50. And this prize, Sveriges Riksbank Prize 2015, this is given in the memory of Alfred Nobel. Nobel Prize is also given in his memory, no? So this is also given in the memory of Alfred Nobel. And this gentleman, Angus Deaton, he got it for his analysis of consumption, poverty and welfare. So, that was the general awareness section, questions number 26 to 50.